home, these are trying times that we're living in. Only in Wisconsin, can a governor and a legislature pass a law that takes 200,000 people away from the polls because of alleged voter suppression or alleged voter irregularity. And they can't find any. And the only irregularity that you have is when somebody found a trunk full of votes so that they get the Supreme Court the way that they wanted it to. You can't make this stuff up. Only in Wisconsin can you have a governor that's elected that says he's going to increase the amount of jobs in the state by 280,000 in his first year, and you bust every union, and Wisconsin is now 49th in job creation. You can't make this stuff up. Only in Wisconsin can you have a governor who was elected the first time around in a recall election in Milwaukee, and now he's whining and crying about he being recalled. You can't make this stuff up. Only in Wisconsin can you have a governor that meets the President of the United States at the airport, shakes his hand, says I've got a bellyache and won't go down to the master lock factory, but will spend 35 minutes on the phone talking to David Koch. You can't make this stuff up. Only in Wisconsin can we have a governor that turns down $870 million from the federal government to run a railroad, high-speed rail from Milwaukee to Madison. And he says he turned it down because if we'd have taken the money, we would have to maintain the railroad, which is the equivalent of turning down $870 million for highways because we'd have to plow the roads in the wintertime. You can't make this stuff up. Only in Wisconsin can you have a governor, after he turns down $870 million, takes money that's allegedly, that's allowed for homeowners who got screwed by the banks on Wall Street. The money is sent to Wisconsin, sent to go back to homeowners to reimburse them. Will he steal the money and put it in to help balance his budget? You can't make this stuff up. Only in Wisconsin, if you've just done your income taxes, in order to raise more revenue, the question on the form is, did you buy anything on eBay or Craigslist this year and not pay the sales tax? Only in Wisconsin. You can't make this stuff up. Only in Wisconsin do you have the signs where it normally says the governor and it says open for business. How about open for people?
Yes.
And my distinct pleasure to introduce to you the next governor of the state of Wisconsin, our senator, our dear friend, Kathleen Vinehout.
Journey just in a few days. I think I've touched almost every side, and by tomorrow I will have touched every side of Wisconsin. About 4 days ago I was in Beloit and Janesville and spoke to just amazing standing room only group of the Rock County Democrats who are all fired up and ready to go. I was in Hayward this weekend and had yet another packed hall full of people at of Bakudere Technical College, and that was a wonderful group of the Sawyer County Democrats, and they did something I've never seen before, where they took the tribe, and the people, the other people that were not tribal members, and had two co-chairs, and that's a way to bring the tribe into the Democratic Party, which I thought was fabulous, and something we can learn about from for our other counties that represent many Native Americans. We had a wonderful meeting of the 3rd Congressional Democrats down in the 3rd CD Democrats down in Alma Center. And I was in Madison, I think it was yesterday, for the People's Legislature. I know there are a few people here who are down in Madison with us. And as you know, then I went over to Manitowoc and touched the east side of the state and met last night with the Manitowoc Democrats and their Proxmire dinner. And so I've collected a little bit of wisdom along the way, and I wanted to share with you a little bit about what I see happening in the next few weeks. Yesterday, I think that I heard that Doug LaFollette is getting into the race. He sounded like it. He showed up at both events. He hasn't been at any of the events that Ms. Falk and I have been in, and I think we must have been at more than a dozen. But he did definitely sound yesterday like he's asking for people's vote, and he has filed his paperwork with the Government Accountability Board. There are still a lot of rumors about Tom Barrett in the Milwaukee area. I think people are kind of waiting to see what's going to happen. I think that Mr. Barrett's going to have to make up his mind very, very soon, because our best information, and this is not for sure, but our best information now is that the Government Accountability Board will probably call the race on Friday, this coming Friday, and then we will have 10 days to circulate nominating papers, and we will have to submit a minimum of 2,000 and a maximum of 4,000 signatures, and we, in our campaign, will be working to get 5,000 signatures from all across the state. At that point, the race will, if it is called as we expect it to be called, the primary will happen on the 8th of May and the general will happen on the 5th of June. There is a lot of uncertainty right now about what's going to happen with the Senate races. You remember there are four Senate recalls, including Terry Moulton and Kristen Dexter over here in North of Eau Claire. And there are candidates in all of those areas, and there's also a race for lieutenant governor, and I get a lot of questions from people asking me, will the governor and the lieutenant governor run together? And the answer is no, they're two different races. And if there's one candidate who's already declared on the Democratic side for lieutenant governor, and that is Malin Mitchell. You remember him now. Malin Mitchell is the president of the Professional Firefighters, and he's a young man who became very, very active in the protests, and he has a very, very good speaker, and I really enjoy being on the dais with him, because he has many, his approach is similar to mine, maybe I should say. He's very passionate, and I believe that he's going to motivate a lot of people to come out. So there's still the question of whether or not the Democrats are going to have to fend off fake Democrats, and we don't know if that's going to happen. And so stay tuned. It's a very exciting time, and we're, like Todd said, only in Wisconsin. I am going to share a little bit of myself and a little bit about why I'm running. And you will see that for those of you that have heard the speech before, you'll see that I've changed quite a bit of the material. But I do want to start with something that's very familiar to you. Everywhere I go, people want to know about what happened a year ago when we were in Illinois. And you remember the story about how I took a call at 6 in the morning and Senator Miller said, don't go into the Capitol because you're going to be followed by a state patrol officer. And 3 hours later, I was intent on making that Illinois border before the gavel fell. I remember the day that I came into that room, and of course, if you know me, you know that I'm early and most of my colleagues are not. And that Senator Miller was the only one in the room when I came in, and he said to me, I'm thinking about Texas. And I said to him, no, I've been thinking about Texas too. And do you know what it would take to stop this? And he said, I called the clerk last night and I asked him, and he said it would be 20 senators. They would have to have 20 senators in order to bring that bill to the floor. And you remember, but many people in the state don't remember, that I won in 2010 when everyone else in this area, many, many, many Senate Democrats lost, and many, many of our good assembly people lost. I won by one vote per ward. I beat a very popular incumbent, Ed Thompson, Tommy Thompson's little brother, an icon in the Monroe County area, and by just one vote per ward. It took 18 days for that election to be certified because the election was so close. But had I not won, the Republicans would have had their 20 senators, and none of what happened in the Capitol would have happened because of what happened right here in Western Wisconsin. And when we're trying to encourage people to vote, we're trying to tell people about this most unusual election, it's incredibly important that you share the story with our friends and neighbors about what happened. One vote per ward in Western Wisconsin changed history. And that story needs to be repeated over and over again. Had I not been elected by people in Western Wisconsin, the Republicans would have had their 20 senators, and none of what made Wisconsin on the national and international stage would have happened. Now that bill that we're talking about, at what became Act 10, when the governor introduced it, he said that there was a fiscal emergency. He said that he had to have a bill in order to deal with a budget problem. Now we know that wasn't true, and it wasn't true originally. We know from the Legislative Fiscal Bureau, the nonpartisan group that does all of our financial information. And we know in the end, when all of the fiscal information was stripped from that bill and collective bargaining was passed on, the repeal of collective bargaining was passed on its own, we knew that it was not a fiscal crisis. But you might not know that right now, today, in Wisconsin, there is a fiscal crisis. Nobody's talking about it, but there is. There's a law that says when the cash drops to a certain level, there's a trigger by law that says the governor and the legislature has to put together a real budget repair bill. Well, that trigger was met earlier this year, but the governor has decided that he's not even going to talk about it, let alone fix the budget. Now, when you think about what's happening, and especially out here in Western Wisconsin, where it's hard to get news of details of what Todd talked about, all those details are, you know, really, they never make it over that great chasm that I think exists in Juneau County, where all the news falls in and very little calls up the other side. It makes its way to Tomah or to Wausau and never makes its way to Hudson. We think the capital's vaguely in St. Paul. But a little bit of inside information. Here's a little secret that I bet you didn't know. You've heard that the governor has talked in his ads about how he's balanced the budget, that he got rid of a $3.5 billion deficit. That is an empty claim. First of all, every single governor and every legislature is required to submit a balanced budget. Meaning, if he has a mismatch between money coming in and money going out, he's somehow got to fix the numbers so everything's equal. Money coming in is equal to money going out. In 2009, we balanced the budget with twice the deficit that he started out with. He never talks about that. The governor in a recent fundraising letter said, and I quote, "Our debts and our deficits are gone." And he said, "I am all about what's doing what's right for Wisconsin." Nothing could be further from the truth. First of all, the current governor has not eliminated the debt, nor has he eliminated the deficit. I told you a little bit about the money in the budget coming in and going out. There's more money going out than coming in. And the debt, which you might equate to the mortgage of the state, all that, the borrowing that's been done to run the state operations, actually rose under this governor. And one of the reasons it rose is because the governor did not pay bills that were coming due, despite what you read and hear in the commercials. And in fact, in the original budget, and this is a secret, don't tell anybody this, I'm kind of getting a little funny because I do want you to tell people, but the governor in his budget proposed
the largest, putting off the largest debt payment in the history of the state in the governor's budget. Now the budget committee didn't want to go there, so they wrote down a little bit so that it wasn't the largest in the state. But in the end, between the budget repair bill and the budget, the governor has postponed paying over $500 million in debt payments that were coming due. It's like you've got a mortgage, or I've got a mortgage on my farm, I've got a payment that's coming, and I say, I don't want to make that payment. I go to my bank and I say, how do I take that payment and make it go away? Well, you and I both know if you make it go away, you're going to pay for it later, and you're going to pay more for it later. And that's exactly what happened in the state budget. $140 million more in interest payments because this was put off. And our children and our grandchildren are going to have to pay for it. Now, the governor has said that all of these recalls are orchestrated by big union bosses and their out-of-state money. Now, maybe he needs to spend more time in Wisconsin and less time raising money in Florida and New York and Missouri and Texas. Yesterday, I received a note from our campaign, and the note came from Dundee, Illinois. And the gentleman who was writing me told me that he and his three friends were sitting talking at the bar about their mail and what had happened in the last couple days. And they were comparing notes, and he said, my friends and I are all to the left of Teddy Kennedy. And we were comparing notes about what we saw coming in our mailbox, and we all three realized that all three of us had received a solicitation from Governor Walker asking us for money for his campaign in Wisconsin. This is Dundee, Illinois. And he said when we started to realize that this had happened to all three of us, we were laughing so hard we fell off our bar stools. Now the truth is that Wisconsin is experiencing a renaissance of democracy. Everywhere I go, there is an energy around this state that I have never seen before, and I don't think has existed in 100 years. Everywhere I go, people are paying attention. People are energized. Places that never have had any Democrats before have a room full of really excited Democrats working very hard. On one of my travels, I went to Washington County and West Bend, which is northern suburb of Milwaukee. It's a very Republican area. In fact, one of my staff people said, I don't think you should go up there. There's probably only 5 Democrats up there. This is the heart of Senator Glenn Grothman's district. He's the fellow who on MSNBC called out the protesters slobs, the most conservative member of the Wisconsin State Senate. Well, when I walked into this hall that we were going to cut the ribbon and open the new headquarters for the Democratic Party, there were 120 really, really excited Democrats. And a day after that, or a few days after that, I went down to Jefferson. And Jefferson is another Republican suburb of Milwaukee. And in Jefferson, I happened to be with Mike Tate, the chair of the Democratic Party. And Mike came and hung his head. You might say, he figuratively, he had his hat in his hand. And he kind of hung his head. And he said, I'm coming here a little bit to eat humble pie. Jefferson is the district in the Senate that's represented by Senator Scott Fitzgerald. And there was an enterprising woman who was a business owner. She's a photographer. She takes wedding pictures for a living. An ordinary person. And she said, I'm not happy with my senator. And I'm going to start collecting recall signatures to recall him. And they asked the state party to help them, and the state party said no. And they started collecting signatures, and they asked the state party again to help them. And the state party said, no, there's no way you're gonna collect enough signatures to recall Scott Fitzgerald. And they asked a third time, and a third time the state party said no. And you know what? They collected enough signatures to recall Scott Fitzgerald. And if you came to Madison yesterday, you would have met Lori Compass, who's now become a folk hero all across the state, who single-handedly got enough people together to collect signatures in one of the most Republican districts and is now running for the state Senate. And Lori and I are very good friends. And we very much come to politics from the same perspective. We believe that democracy is all about people, not about money. And I see that happening in my campaign every day, where thousands of volunteers are taking it upon themselves to get started and get Kathleen Vinehout elected. And the volunteers are coming together, they're canvassing, in a week they're gonna be collecting nomination signatures, they're writing their friends, they're painting their own yard signs. And I know this is kind of small and you can't see it, but hopefully in a week I'll have a much bigger version. But we now have an artist in residence in our campaign, volunteer of course, who was inspired by our campaign so much so that she painted a painting in honor of our campaign. And it's the Capitol and beautiful, beautiful lake behind it with sailboats. And it says in that big banner, a fresh start for Wisconsin. And then there's little signs that say strong, thoughtful, I can't read it all, independent, loyal. And then there's the cow down in the bottom that's holding a flag that says utterly effective. And there is a box right in the middle. And the box says, recall signatures. What is happening across Wisconsin is that ordinary citizens are taking back our democracy. It was those 14 ordinary citizens that performed that brilliant defensive strategy in the first half of our fight. Men who didn't have t-shirts or underwear. Women who had left, including myself, who had left their children behind. Senators who didn't have essential medication or phone chargers, which all these, everybody knows you have to have a phone charger. And you may remember, we stayed with my sister in Woodstock, Illinois, the 14 senators, until we were discovered by the Tea Party people. And we found out later that there was a Tea Party person who was across the cul-de-sac in my sister's little part of her neighborhood who had been watching us with a telescope come and go for a whole week when he was watching all these Wisconsin plates, and it took him a whole week to figure out those senators were right under his nose.
And he was the smart one.
Showed up with their signs right outside my sister's house, I decided I kind of had overstayed my welcome. But it might have been because my brother-in-law kept going to Fleet Farm to buy more men's t-shirts of many different sizes. So in response to us staying away, thousands of protesters showed up. And they shouted, this is what democracy looks like. And they held hands and sang, we shall overcome. And thousands of people all over the state collected signatures. And now there are a million Wisconsinites, ordinary citizens, who have a lot of gardening and spring cleaning to do. And we're getting out our mops and our pails, and we're ready to start sweeping. And I'm really glad I didn't get rid of my barn boots, because I'm gonna need them, because we know the biggest spring cleaning job is cleaning out that governor's office. Now the heroes we wanted to come and save us are right here. They are right among us. Does anyone know who the legendary box carriers are? Please give Nan and any other legendary box carriers.
Now the legendary box carriers are those brave men and women who carried the box from the petitions from the U-Haul trailer up the stairs to the Government Accountability Board. And if you were in Black River Falls or down in Alma Center, you may have met Sheila Danielson, who a few months ago was at a recall rally in Black River Falls, and she was one of the coordinators in Jackson County. She told this very moving story about what it was like to be one of the legendary box carriers. And she told it with tears in her eyes. And the story is that Sheila said when she first picked up the box, it was very, very heavy. And she said in the box was the pain of losing a job, the heartbreak of a home in foreclosure, the fear of a parent of losing that health insurance for their child. She said, as I started to walk, I saw all the people lined up on either side, and I'm sure you can tell the same story, and I heard their cheers, and the box became lighter, and I felt the hopes, and the dreams, and the dedication, and the respect of people from all over the state. And when I made it up the stairs to the top of the Government Accountability Board stairs to the top of the office, she said that box was as light as a feather. And the world saw the fruits of our labor. And I think the man who first talked about the idea of a recall election on the floor of the Wisconsin Assembly in 1905, Governor Bob Follett, would indeed be proud. We will demonstrate clearly, as Governor Follett said, the cure for the ills of democracy is more democracy. And this can only be accomplished when we work together. Ladies and gentlemen, we are the people that we've been waiting for. We are the change that we want to see. Now, as Clint Eastwood said in that halftime commercial, on the Super Bowl commercial, it's halftime. We played a magnificent first half. We began with a brilliant strategy from the Wisconsin 14, leading the state and the protesters arriving in force. It was an amazing defensive strategy. But now we must turn to offense, and we need a new governor. Yeah. We need a fresh start in Wisconsin government and politics. We need a new beginning. Somehow we must heal the divisions among us. We must respect each other while we debate our differences. We must stop pitting business and labor against each other as if they were enemies. We have to stop driving a wedge between the public sector and the private sector. We are all in this together. We are all suffering. We need everyone's best effort to create the kind of communities that we want to live in and work in and raise a family. We need a fresh start in government and politics. And take a deep breath with me and imagine what that would look like. We need a leader who would respect Wisconsin's traditions of openness, of good government, of full participation, of bringing everyone to the table, of following the rules. I wrote a bill in the legislature, I wrote two of them, to require the legislature to follow the open meetings laws. Of course, like most of the Senate Democrats' bills, those bills never had a hearing under the Republican, what shall I call it, monarchy that we're now living under.
Right.
But as the leader of the state, I will follow those rules, those very rules that our local governments are required to follow. I will uncover the black boxes. For example, the Wisconsin Economic Development Corporation, this black box that used to be the Department of Commerce. Those dark dealings will be made public. And those state contracts will be open. And contractors will deliver quality products on time, and all of that information will be made public so anybody that wants to do business with the state can. Now we need a leader who will listen to the people and do the will of the people.
Yes.
And everywhere I go, the will of the people is a fairly funded education system that focuses on the needs of our students and honors and respects our education professionals.
Yeah, yeah.
And the will of the people is affordable health care for all.
Yeah.
And that can be done. And one of the first things I do is call Kathleen Sebelius on the phone and say, Kathleen, this is Kathleen, I need that money back. Money that should be used to create an affordable health insurance exchange so small businesses and farmers and people who buy insurance on their own can get the same low rates that big groups get. That needs to happen. And the will of the people is an economy that moves into the 21st century with broadband in Western Wisconsin. Is manure digesters. On Saturday, I was with my friends at the Lacouturay tribe, and I was reminded of what it means to protect the environment, as my Native American friends say, unto the seventh generation. We've had a lot of discussion about mines, both sand mines in western Wisconsin and iron ore mines in the north. And Mike Wiggins from the Bad River Tribe spoke at the event that I was at, and he talked about protecting our environment for the next 300 to 400 years. Can you imagine what decisions we would make if we thought about our world for the next 400 years? Instead, we can't think beyond 18 months. And look at where that has gotten us, into weather that we can't predict from hour to hour. We need a leader who thinks unto the seventh generation.
Yes. Yes.
We need a leader who governs with self-restraint. And there is no self-restraint in that fake David Koch phone call where the governor laughed about dropping the bomb on his own people. There's no self-restraint. And we need a leader who's going to be truthful about her intentions. I will be that kind of leader. Many times people ask me, especially in Western Wisconsin, what can you do about those people at the Capitol? Can't you change them? And I say to them, I can only change one person, and that is myself. I so live my life by the saying of Gandhi, be the change you want to see. Wisconsin needs a fresh start in Wisconsin government and politics, and we can be that change. So tonight, I challenge you.
Yeah.
If you don't like money in politics, work for the candidate with less money. Be the change you want to see. If you don't like scripted sound bites, work for the candidate who respects your intelligence.
Yes.
If you don't like negative campaigning, work for the candidate that talks solutions and doesn't talk trash. And if you don't like politics as usual, work for the unusual. Win at a game where our opponents have tried to rewrite all the rules. They changed the rules about money in elections with the Citizens United decision. They tried to change the rules on the legislative districts, but a court said that they didn't do a very good job over in Milwaukee when they tried to limit the Latino vote. They changed the rules related to voting, which you will now, maybe if you go to vote soon on April 3rd, you will find out that there's a court injunction that says we don't have to follow any of those rules either because that law was declared unconstitutional. And I know this because I just sat down last Saturday with my clerk, and if you live in a rural community, you know that if you vote absentee, you vote with your clerk at your clerk's kitchen table out in the country. And that's how I vote, and my clerk never asked me for my ID, even though she's known me for 20 years. But they haven't changed the most important rule, ladies and gentlemen, and that is one person, one vote.
Yeah.
And when people turn out in unprecedented numbers, we have the power of the people. Now, we have a very important task in front of us. Just like the Wisconsin 14, we must make that bold and courageous step, step outside of our comfort zone, and start to talk with people around us about the election. And we need to do more than talk. We need to collect those nominating signatures to get us on the, to get Senator Vinehout on the ballot. We need to make sure that the people know in Hudson exactly what's happened in Milwaukee and then in Madison, the story that Todd just told us. We need to make sure that the people who signed those recall petitions actually get contacted with a piece of literature. And this is going to be door to door, ladies and gentlemen, because I don't have enough money to mail every single voter in the state. And we need to make sure that those people get to the polls on election day. Every single one of them. Because remember, if it wasn't for one senator in western Wisconsin, one vote per ward, none of this would have happened. We have to take that message to everyone. We will show everyone in this world that we are awake, that we are engaged, that we are fighting for our future, the future of our state. Because when we become the change we want to see, our communities change, our state changes, and we change. And it can happen one person at a time, right now, right here, tonight. Thank you very much.